Magandang araw po sa inyong lahat and welcome once again to our third pre-recorded lecture for the subject Nursing Care of the High-Risk Newborn to Maturity. I am Dr. Jeff Leigh Reburon and we will be discussing about the problems related to gestational weight in this video lecture. So ilabas na po ang inyong mga handouts so that we can continue our lesson. Our first topic will be on the small for gestational age infant or those we call SGA. Ano ba kasi yung mga tinatawag natin na SGA infants? These are infants whose weight is below the 10th percentile on the intrauterine growth curve for that specific age. We sometimes call them microsomnia, and when we speak of SGA, they are considerably much more lighter or much more smaller in size compared to those who are on their AGA or appropriate for gestational age. So when you compare, kunwari, a one-month-old child to another one-month-old child, yung SGA, considerably mas lighter yung itsura niya, mas thinner at mas maliit compared sa child who is appropriate for gestational age. So that is basically the small for gestational age infant in a nutshell. Now, the SGA is a condition which is usually due to intrauterine growth restriction or what we call IUGR, or they failed to grow at the expected rate in utero. So basically, during their development in the intrauterine in their intrauterine life, what happens was they failed to get the needed nutrients and minerals from the mother, or basically there was a disease condition that may have caused them to not grow and develop as expected. And you can expect that this small for gestational age infant will weigh less than 2.5 kilograms when you weigh them during their birth weight. Yun po ang ating mga SGA. Now, pag-usapan naman natin kung ano yung mga reasons kung bakit nagkakaroon ng mga small for gestational age infants. And number one culprit for that is inadequate maternal nutrition. If the mother is not eating well, if the mother is not eating healthy, what happens is that even the growth and development of the fetus gets affected. And when the fetus fails to get the needed nutrients and minerals that it needs for it to grow and develop properly and appropriately, ang mangyayari is that pregnancy will result to small for gestational age. Aside from that, it can also be caused by early pregnancy. Yung mga teenage moms na masyadong maagang nangasawa or nagkaanak or nabuntis, like for example, 12, 13 years old, nabubuntis na sila, they can become, their pregnancies can result to small for gestational age. Ang nangyayari kasi is that during the pregnancy, pati yung mga adolescents natin na nagkaroon ng early pregnancy, they are also on their growth spurt. Ibig sabihin, kinakailangan din ng katawan nila to consume nutrients and minerals and energy for it to grow properly. So imagine, no, yung isang bata na nag-grow at nagne-develop pa lang ay kailangan ding supplyan yung isang fetus growing inside her. Ang mangyayari is that there will be intrauterine growth retardation. So that may be a result of the small for gestation. That can result to the small for gestational age infant. Kasi nga, yung bata, yung adolescent na teenage pregnant, ang mangyayari is that mag-aagawan sila ng nutrients with the kid and eventually mako-compromise po yung growth and development ng fetus because of too early pregnancy. Aside from that, it can also be caused by placental anomaly. Pag sinabi po nating placental anomaly, this is the most common cause of the small for gestational age. And that the placenta, because of a certain abnormality, may not have acquired the sufficient nutrients from the uterine arteries. So anong nangyayari? Nagkaroon ng deficiency of blood, nutrients, and minerals that goes from the placenta to the baby. Therefore, hindi na nourish ng maigi yung fetus, and when it comes out, it is small for gestational age. Aside from that, it can also be an efficiency in transporting the nutrients. So maaari pong yung umbilicus din yung affected doon. So the placenta may be absorbing nutrients or blood from the uterus, but the problem is yung transportation mismo ng mga nutrients and blood na ito ang nagkaroon ng problema. Therefore, this blood or these nutrients did not reach the baby or the fetus, therefore, nagkaroon ng small for gestational age. So those are one of the three main causes of small for gestational age. Although marami pang mga iba, which we will be discussing later on. Now another cause of small for gestational age infants is placental damage, specifically when there is partial placental separation. Ang nangyayari kasi is that when there is partial placental separation, it leads to poor functioning of the placenta. Bakit po kayo nagkakaroon ng ganon? What happens is that you have to remember that the placenta is connected to the uterine lining using the placental villi. Ang mangyayari is that if it prematurely separates or nagkaroon ng partial separation, ang mangyayari is that this open wound will become fibrosed or scarred. Therefore, it will reduce the placental functioning of absorbing blood and delivering this amount of blood or sustenance to the fetus. So, ang mangyayari, because of too much scarring, nagkakaroon po ng mas mababang functioning yung placenta because it will not anymore be able to absorb the adequate amount of blood for the growth of the fetus. So, mangyayari is that it will result, the pregnancy will result too small for gestational age. Another reason for SGA is the presence of systemic diseases like diabetes mellitus, or you also have your pregnancy-induced hypertension. Ang nangyayari kasi if you have diabetes mellitus or pregnancy-induced hypertension is that your blood vessels get narrowed. And dahil sa pangit ngayong circulation, it will also reduce placental functioning kasi nga mas kokonti na lang yung maa-absorb na dugo ng placenta from the uterus because of the narrowing of the blood vessels. And therefore, mas kokonti lang din, mas deficient yung blood supply that goes to the baby. Therefore, the pregnancy is expected to result to small for gestational age. Another is the use of narcotics and heavy smoking. Research studies have shown that if a mother is a drug addict or if the mother is a chain smoker, the pregnancy will definitely result to small for gestational age. And kung tutuusin, when we look at that, it can be possible kasi nga nicotine also and some drugs also result to the narrowing of blood vessels. Kaya nga yung mga nagda-drugs na high is pati yung mga blood pressure nila lumalakas din because of the narrowing of the blood vessel or vasoconstriction. So, the use of narcotics and heavy smoking, it can lead to small for gestational age. Aside from that, yung pinag-usapan natin last time na torch infections, when there is an intrauterine infection, specifically pag merong rubella, toxoplasmosis, or other chromosomal abnormalities, this can all lead to small for gestational age. Ang nangyayari kasi is that the placenta delivers sufficient nutrients but the newborn cannot use them because of the presence of infection. So, hindi po dahil sa insufficiency of the functioning of the placenta kaya nagkaroon ng small for gestational age. It is primarily because the child has infection and the child was not able to process or use the blood that is supplied by the placenta because of the presence of these conditions like rubella, toxoplasmosis, and other chromosomal abnormalities. So those are the 7 causes of small for gestational age. Now, how will we know if there is a possibility or a chance that the pregnancy will result to small for gestational age? Marami tayong mga pwedeng gawin. And number 1 is the use of fundicate. So, dapat po minemeasure natin kung gaano nakalaki or kataas yung kanyang baby bump or yung kanilang abdomen. Because when you measure the fundicate or the size of the uterus, it tells you the size of the baby growing inside the womb. So you can expect that the fundicate of a small for gestational age fetus will be less than expected or mas maliit siya kesa sa normal. May mga iba magsasabi, term na ako pero parang 4 months pregnant pa lang sila. Those are what we call small fundicate that may result too small for gestational age. However, yung isang assessment natin na ginagawa, which is measuring the fundicate, may not be that accurate, especially if the mother is not able to remember her last menstrual period, because there is no way for us to be able to calculate her age of gestation. Kaya minsan, pag hindi alam ng nanay yung LMP niya, so hindi rin natin alam exactly how old that pregnancy is already. Now, alagi niyong tatandaan ano, that when you measure the fundic height, you are able to know the normal fundic height, especially if the pregnancy is already 24 weeks. Kasi ang mangyayari is that if a mother's fundic height during the 24 weeks of gestation, pag minesure mo siya, dapat it will match the same weeks of gestation. Just give it 2, plus 2 or minus 2. So for example, a mother who is 24 weeks pregnant, alam mo dapat na ang kanyang normal na fundic height ay it will match the age of gestation, plus 2 or minus 2. So you can expect that a mother who is 24 weeks pregnant will have a fundic height of 22 to 26 centimeters. Ganoon dapat siya kalaki. So it will match the weeks of gestation, pag 24 weeks or more, and then plus 2 or minus 2 centimeters. But less than that, you can expect that there will be small for gestational age infant. Sana klaro tayo doon, pag 24 weeks old na yung pregnancy, pag kukunin mo yung fundic height, you can expect that the age of gestation will match the fundic height minus 2 plus 2. Alright. Another way for us to detect small for gestational age is through the use of sonogram or ultrasound. So it will demonstrate the decrease in size of the growing fetus. So titignan nyo no, sa parang picture natin na nilagay ko dito, you can see as well that the fetus is already very small compared to its gestational age. So using that as your visual reference, the doctor can immediately say, magiging small for gestational age, or misis, maliit yung fetus mo, so baka kukulangin din siya ng timbang because it is small for gestational age. Malalaman lang natin yon if we are if we can see the ultrasound results of the mother. Aside from that, we can also do biophysical prenatal assessment. Okay? Madedetect natin yung ating small for gestational age if we subject the mother to non-stress test, pwede ding placental grading or amniotic fluid amounts, i-check natin. Ano pa yung mga ultrasound examination? These all provide information regarding the placental functions. Malalaman natin kung nagkaroon ng problema yung placenta, di ba sinabi natin that a major reason why there is a small for gestational age is an abnormality in the placenta. So when we do non-stress test, placental grading, mga ganong tipo, we are able to note for the presence of the abnormality of the placenta. At kung meron mang positive na mga results na ganun, na may abnormality yung placenta, we can expect that the pregnancy will also result to small for gestational age. So those are the things that we can do to assess or evaluate for small for gestational age. Now, marahil nagtataka kayo kung anong itsura ng isang SGA newborn. The small for gestational age newborn will usually have a wasted appearance. And pag titignan natin siya, parang mas maliit siya compared to the usual na newborns na ating hinahandle. And sometimes, these SGA babies may also display a small liver. Maliit yung kanilang liver, and the problem with that is that they will have difficulty regulating their glucose. They will also have problems regulating protein and bilirubin levels. So that is usually typical in small for gestational age newborns for them to have smaller livers, which will have difficulty regulating all these components in the body. Aside from that, yung kanilang poor skin turgor din ay poor or hindi bouncy yung kanilang skin, typically parang meron silang dehydrated appearance. Aside from that, there is also an abnormally large head while the rest of the body part is small. You have to remember ano that the growth and development specifically in the, during the intrauterine life is cephalocaudal. So ang nangyayari is that malaki yung uli nila while the rest of the body part is small kasi the growth and development starts here and it goes down. So yan yung isang makikita natin that the head is large while the rest of the body part is small. Yung ulo lang niya yung malaki. Aside from that, the skull head is widely separated. Ibig sabihin, there is also poor bone growth. Hindi masyadong naka-absorb ng calcium yung kanilang katawan. Therefore, mas makikita mo yung mga suture lines niya. They are widely separated. Yung mga cranial bones mo, sobrang magkakalayo. Because of yun nga, the presence of suture and there are sutures, yung mga spaces connecting the skull bones, nagkakaroon kayo ng mga ganon because of poor bone growth. There is also hair that is dull and lusterless or not shiny, and the cord may also be sunken. Bakit pwedeng maging sunken yung cord niya? Because of underdeveloped abdominal organs. And also, the cord may also appear dry and stained yellow. So, you have to remember that SGAs need careful assessment for possible congenital anomalies. Kasi nga, nasabi natin na meron silang maaaring cord that appears to be dry and stained yellow, or maaaring meron silang abnormally large head or small liver. So, dapat we need to evaluate and assess these patients as much as possible to rule out presence of any congenital anomalies that may typically appear in SGA newborns. Okay, so bakit sila pwedeng magkaroon ng congenital anomalies? Because it may be a result of poor intrauterine nutrition. Dahil sa pangit yung kanilang nutrition, their body organs were not able to develop properly. Hence, there is a possibility na yung mga organs nila like the heart, the lungs, the brain, the liver may have congenital anomalies. So you also have to be very careful and vigilant in looking for these signs and symptoms. Now, it is also important for us to look at the blood values of the small for gestational age infant or neonate that we are handling. At ano yung mga primary na tinitignan natin sa mga blood studies ng ating patients? Number one is hematocrit. When we speak of hematocrit, it means the concentration of RBC with regards to plasma. And when there is high hematocrit level, nakikita po yan sa mga small for gestational age infants or neonate. Pag sinabi kasi nating high yung kanyang hematocrit, there is low level of plasma, which is the fluid component of the blood in proportion with the RBC. Okay? So bakit meron siyang hematocrit? Because of lack of fluids. Makikita natin na yung isang patient ay merong high hematocrit kung mas viscous yung kanyang dugo or mas malapot. Bakit mas malapot? Kasi mas marami yung RBC as compared sa plasma level sa dugo. So dahil sa mas konti lang yung fluid, as mas marami yung kanilang RBC, therefore nagkakaroon siya ng hematocrit concentration at nagkakaroon ng viscosity of the blood. Aside from that, when we look at the RBC level of these small for gestational age infants, makakakita din tayo ng polycythemia sa kanila. When we speak of polycythemia, it means increase in the red blood cells. And this causes blood viscosity katulad din ng increased hematocrit. Okay? So maaaring tumataas yung hematocrit level nila kasi nga mas maraming RBC level yung mga small for gestational age infants. And because of blood viscosity, it will lead to additional workload of the heart. Bakit? Kasi mas thicker yung dugo, mas mahirap na ipitik ng puso or i-circulate ng puso palabas of the heart. Therefore, the thick blood is much more difficult to effectively be circulated by the circulatory system. So, ito yung mga usually blood studies na tinitignan natin sa mga small for gestational age infants. Yung hematocrit and the presence of polycythemia. Now, doing in visual inspection to the small for gestational age newborn, makakakita din po kayo ng acrocyanosis.
And when we talk about acrocyanosis, it means the bluish discoloration of the extremities. The hands and the feet are blue, while the rest of the body part are pink. Okay? So, bakit nagkakaroon po ng acrocyanosis or bakit normal po sa mga SGA yung acrocyanosis? It is because of the increased blood viscosity. Di ba nasabi natin kanina that there is polycythemia and there is high hematocrit level in the small for gestational age infant. At dahil nga sa mataas yung kanilang hematocrit at meron silang polycythemia or marami silang RBC, what happens is that the blood is very viscous. Napalit or malapot po yung dugo ng small for gestational age infant. And what happens? The body is hard up in pumping this viscous blood. Therefore, the body can only supply the central circulation, pero sa peripheral circulation or your circulation involving the extremities, hindi na niya halos masupplyan because of the difficulty of pumping this viscous blood. Kaya nga po nakakakita tayo ng acrocyanosis for patients who are small for gestational age. Now also, there are instances wherein there is severe polycythemia. Sa sobrang daming RBC ng mga bata or ng mga small for gestational age infants, their blood vessels may become blocked, leading to thrombus or clot formation. So, maaari ding isang maging problema yan in your small for gestational age because of the thrombus formation or clotting within the blood vessels. Now, we can also see signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia. Yung bata parang nagugutom. Okay? So, when we speak of hypoglycemia, it means low level of blood glucose, which is less than 40 milligrams per deciliter. Okay? So, sir, bakit nagkakaroon ng hypoglycemia si small for gestational age infant? It is because of decreased glycogen stores of the small for gestational age. Anong ibig sabihin? Konti lang kasi yung mga taba nila. Yung mga taba or your glycogen stores, this can be converted by the body to become energy because these glycogen stores will become glucose pag i-convert na siya ng katawan. But since these infants were not able to store enough energy kasi nga pwedeng problematic yung kanilang placenta, or because there is a poor maternal nutrition, so they were not able to store the needed energy or glycogen na kailangan nila, ang mangyayari is that they will experience hypoglycemia. So, basically, we can treat this hypoglycemia by giving the child intravenous glucose transfusion. Kaya yung mga ibang small for gestational age, binibigyan nila ng D50-50. Okay? Na dextrose, 50% dextrose in water. So, yun yung ibibigay. Or we can also give them breastfeeding if the small for gestational infant can effectively suck. As long as kaya niyang mag-breastfeeding, bigyan nyo na po siya para ma-counteract yung effects ng hypoglycemia. As nurses, you also have to be very vigilant in looking for possible problems in the small for gestational age infant. Okay? So, ano yung mga pwedeng maging problema ng mga SGAs? Number one is ineffective breathing pattern that is related to underdeveloped body systems at birth. Ibig sabihin, this small for gestational age neonates will be hard up in initiating breathing. Bakit sila mahihirap ang huminga? Because of possible underdeveloped chest muscles. Dahil hindi pa ganun ka-mature yung kanilang mga chest muscles, they will not be able to function properly. Therefore, they might impede initiation of breathing. Aside from that, maaari din silang magkaroon ng ineffective breathing pattern because majority of small for gestational age neonates will suffer from meconium aspiration. Sir, paano naman? Diba, sinabi ko natin kanina na for small for gestational age fetus, ang nangyayari is that the placenta is hard up in getting blood or oxygen from the uterus. Kasi problematic na yung placenta. So what happens? If there is a lack of blood being transported from the placenta going to the baby, therefore, mababa din yung oxygen level ng fetus. Okay? So when there is a low level of oxygen or what we call anoxia, ang mangyayari is that, kasi nga konti yung blood supply from the placenta going to the baby. So, konti yung blood supply, konti din yung oxygen supply ng fetus. What happens is that if there is fetal distress, okay, konti lang yung oxygen sa katawan ng fetus, there will be reflex relaxation of the anal sphincter. Okay? So, nung sasabihin ng bata, yung kunwari ito yung kanyang anal sphincter, kung mababa yung kanyang oxygen level, what happens is that the anal sphincter will relax. Okay? So, mag-open yung kanyang anal sphincter. And what will happen? Sabi din dito, if there is anoxia, there will also be increased peristaltic movement. So, yung mga intestines din nila, mag-i-increase yung motility. Therefore, pag nag-relax yan dahil sa konti yung oxygen or anoxia, lalabas yung meconium. So, the fetus will swallow the amniotic fluid mixed with meconium, and this meconium will go to the lungs, which will cause it to be inflamed. Therefore, there will be ineffective breathing pattern if the SGA baby gets delivered. So, what will we do? We resuscitate the child as much as possible kasi nga mahihirapan niyan to initiate breathing. Aside from that, we also have to monitor the respiratory rate and the character of the respiration in the first few hours of life because we might need to transfer this child to advanced healthcare facilities because the child might need to be placed in mechanical ventilators kasi nga mahihirapan silang huminga. So that's number one problem for the small for gestational age neonate, the ineffective breathing pattern related to underdeveloped body systems at birth. Another possible problem that we might encounter when taking care for small for gestational age infants is the presence of ineffective thermoregulation related to lack of subcutaneous fats. Di ba nga konti lang yung mga stored na glycogen ng mga bata. Therefore, konti lang din yung kanilang mga subcutaneous fats. Konti lang yung kanilang mga energy stores. So what happens? The child will not be able to regulate its own temperature. So the child will be prone to hypothermia. So what do? We have to carefully control the temperature or the environment of the child by placing the child in either an incubator, an infant warmer, or under the drop light. Or kung wala naman, we can also advise the parents to dress the child properly, dry the child properly, do skin-to-skin contact or kangaroo care. So those are the things that we can do to counteract the ineffective thermoregulation, which is related to lack of subcutaneous fats in small for gestational age neonates or infants. Now, another problem that we might encounter when we are taking care of small for gestational age infants or patients is the risk for impaired parenting related to the child's high-risk status. Di ba nga, the child is very small, the child is seen as a very fragile organism or being. So what happens? Matatakot yung mga magulang nila to take care of these children because they look very delicate and fragile. So what do we do? Number one is we can teach or empower these parents to properly take care of their young. So what we can do is we can discuss ways in which those parents can promote the infant's development at home. Turuan natin sila kung paano hawakan, alagaan, pakainin itong mga small for gestational age newborns so that they can also catch up during their growth and development. Aside from that, we also have to encourage the parents to provide toys to these small for gestational age kids when they grow up that are suitable. Yung mga toys dapat na binibigay nila are suitable for their child's age, and play should also come with rest periods as well. So dapat, like I said, even if these children or these neonates were born small for gestational age, you have to remember that they should also be given normal childhoods. So pwedeng paglaruin din sila, giving them toys that are age appropriate, and then giving them enough rest and relaxation in between playing so that they will also grow and develop properly. Laging tatandaan na kailangan po ng play ng isang bata for them to develop sensory and motor skills that are necessary for their growth and development. Aside from that, you let parents provide care and stimulation to the child by saying na, Mrs., dapat alagaan nyo yung mga anak nyo, dapat you are talking to them, giving them play, giving them visual stimulants para po the rest of the body parts can also be stimulated and they will also be encouraged to grow and develop properly. So, yun yung mga pwede natin gawin to counteract risk for impaired parenting related to child's high-risk status. Now, since this video is pre-recorded, ano ho, I have no idea if you're still watching this video or not. So, kailangan kong mag-attendance check in the middle of the video so that I will know if you skipped the video or hindi. Okay? So, how will we check the attendance for this session? Ang gusto kong gawin nyo is that you will send me a picture of the meal that you are having for lunch. And then you send it to our Facebook Messenger. And only those who will be sending a picture of their plate with food before or during the 7 o'clock p.m. mark will have their attendance checked. Okay? So yung mga pagkain nyo during your lunch period or yung dinner, pwede din. You can also send that, a picture of your meal. You can send that on our Facebook Messenger group chat. Alright, so that's how I'm going to check your attendance for today's session. Now, next thing that we will be discussing is the large for gestational age infants, or what we call the LGA. These are infants whose weight is above the 90th percentile on an intrauterine growth chart for that gestational age. We also call them macrosomia. Itong mga batang to, they appear deceptively healthy. Parang pagtitigdan natin sila, sasabihin natin, ang cute naman ng bata, napaka-healthy because they are more than 4 kilograms at birth. May mga iba, pinapanganak 5 kilograms at birth. And people will think, ala, ang healthy ng batang to. Okay? But, our nursing assessments will reveal that there are also problems related to immature development and other problems related to the large for gestational age. Hindi, mukha lang silang healthy, but they are not really. So, that's gonna be a problem as well. Now, marahil nagtataka kayo kung bakit nagkakaroon ng large for gestational age infants or neonates. Now, the simple answer to that is that large for gestational age newborns have been subjected to overproduction of growth hormones in utero. And isa sa mga reasons for that is the presence of conditions like diabetes mellitus. The fetus in diabetes mellitus is exposed to high glucose levels in utero. Kung yung nanay po ay meron siyang diabetes, the blood is very rich in sugar. And yung mga sugars na ito pupunta sa bata. Okay? Pupunta sa fetus. What happens is that the blood of the fetus is also rich in glucose, pero yung bata, sasabihin niya, magpuproduce ako ng insulin. I will ensure that this glucose will be stored because of the insulin I am producing. Kaya ang mangyayari, the child will accumulate so much glycogen stores, kaya siya mananaba. So pag mataba yung bata because of diabetes mellitus, there is a chance that there will be large for gestational age. Kaya nga po, yung mga doctors, yung mga OB, pinipigilan nila yung mga nanay to take so much or to drink so much Pepsi, Coca-Cola, or other carbonated drinks or sugary drinks kasi nga po, it can lead to LGA. Alright? So, bawal-bawal din yung mga maraming rice, white bread, because all of these can turn into sugars when we eat them. And then they can cause LGA pag pregnant yung pasyente. Okay? Aside from that, LGAs are also linked to obese mothers. So there is a high chance that the pregnancy will result to LGA if the mother is also obese. Okay? Kung anong puno, siya ang bunga. Aside from that, there is also a possibility of LGA, especially in mothers with grand multiparity. Pag sinabi po natin grand multiparity, ito po yung mga nanay na nagbubuntis ng 5 times, 6 times, 7 times, yung mga anak is sunod-sunod, ang tawag po natin doon ay grand multiparity if you have already been pregnant for many times already. Bakit po? There is a research study that shows that for multiparous women, they are more prone to deliver large for gestational age because with each pregnancy, babies will tend to grow larger. So the more daw na nagiging pregnant ka, palaki ng palaki yung magiging anak mo. Alright, so one factor or one cause of LGA may also be grand multiparity. There are also other conditions such as transposition of the great vessel. So yung inyong pulmonary vein and yung aorta nyo nagkabaliktad. Pwedeng isang reason din yan kung bakit merong large for gestational age. You also have your Beckwith syndrome. Your Beckwith Weidman syndrome. Yung makikita nyo ngayon dyan sa screen natin, yung Beckwith-Weidman syndrome is a condition that affects many parts of the body of the neonate. And it is classified as an overgrowth syndrome. Okay? At ang naaapekto dito is that there is macrosomia kasi nga meron siyang overgrowth. And some of these children may become taller than their peers during childhood. Ano yung mga makikita nating signs and symptoms in the Beckwith-Weidman syndrome? Number one is macrosomia or large body size of the baby. Meron din silang macroglossia or large tongue. Malaki yung dila ng bata na may Beckwith-Weidman syndrome. There is also abdominal wall defect. Also increased risk of childhood tumor, kidney abnormalities, and then hypoglycemia or low blood sugar levels, and then unusually large ears or creases on the armpits, mga ganong tipo po. So those are the signs and symptoms of the Beckwith-Weidman syndrome na pwede ding mag-cause ng large for gestational age. Okay? Or other congenital anomalies such as omphalocele, all of them can cause LGAs. Now, how will we know if there is a possibility for large for gestational age na yung pregnancy ay magre-result sa LGA? Now, what we can do is we should do prenatal assessment to detect it. By using the woman's fundic height or looking at the size of the uterus, we can see that the uterus or the fundic height is unusually large compared to other pregnancies that we are handling. So, pag nakita natin na sobrang laki yung tiyan ng nanay, ang automatic na pumapasok sa isip natin, nanay, baka yung anak mo ay twins or multiple pregnancy, yun pala, LGA lang. Okay? So, this may be deceptive since the fetus is in fetal position, so hindi natin malalaman if there is really twins or it's only LGA unless we don't only rely on the woman's fundic height but also subject her to ultrasound or sonogram. So, ang mangyayari is that when we subject the mother to ultrasound, the ultrasound results will show the increase in size of the fetus at i-disprove din yung ating claim na baka multiple pregnancy. So, we can only be sure that there is only a singleton or isa lang siya sa loob ng womb at malaki lang talaga siya if we subject the mother to ultrasound. At pag nakita natin that there is a possibility for large for gestational age, ano? Pag nakita natin that the ultrasound reveals that the child is already very big, okay? What we can do is subject the mother to the non-stress test. Okay? Yung tinatawag natin na NS test or the non-stress test is sometimes called the cardiotocography. Okay? Cardiotocography, and it records the baby's movement. So, tinitignan yung paggalaw ng bata, the heartbeat of the child or the FHT, and it also looks at the contractions of the mother. Kaya nga, meron tayong nilalagay na parang probe dito sa or detector na nilalagay natin dito sa fundus, tapos nandun din sa part kung saan natin nakukuha yung FHT, and then we also give the mother parang mga click pen na ikiklik ng mother yun kada gumagalaw yung bata. Because, like I said, nire-record nito yung contraction, kaya naglalagay tayo dun sa fundus. ng detector. We also place a detector on the place or the quadrant where we hear the heartbeat or the FHT. And then yung kanyang baby's movement naman, sin mother lang yung makakadetect nun, so she will click it every time that the baby or the fetus moves. Okay? So, bakit natin kailangang ilagay sa non-stress test si mother who has large for gestational age fetus? Kailangan natin i-test yung mother for the non-stress test because we want to look into the ability of the placenta to sustain the large fetus. Kasi nga po, baka sa sobrang laki ng bata, hindi na kayang isuplayan ni placenta yung kanyang size. And that may also pose as a problem. Like for example, pwedeng magkaroon ng fetal distress yung bata, leading to meconium staining. So there is a possibility na baka mag-CS, mag-emergency CS sila if the placenta cannot anymore supply the needed oxygen and blood to the very large fetus. So dapat yun po yung gagawin natin, check for the fundic height. At pag nakita nating sobrang laki yon, we may also think of possibilities like for example, polyhydramnios or pwedeng large for gestational age or pwedeng multiple birth, but we can only confirm that through ultrasound. At pag nakita natin na malaki ngayong bata, LGA ngayon, we subject the mother to non-stress test to look at the ability of the placenta to supply the demands of the very big fetus. Alright? As I mentioned earlier, na kailangan nating i-check yung placental functions kasi nga the placenta might not be able to fulfill the demands of the large for gestational age fetus, kailangan din nating mag-perform ng amniocentesis. When we speak of amniocentesis, it means the aspiration and testing of the amniotic fluid. So, gagamit tayo ng syringe and we will puncture the abdomen of the mother, especially ito po ay guided by the ultrasound, ano? As you see in the picture. So, we will use a syringe and we will puncture the abdomen, getting a sample of the amniotic fluid. At ano kasi yung titignan natin doon? We will look for lung, the possibility of lung maturity. Okay, titignan natin yon and we will test the amniotic fluid and we will see if there is already mature lungs. Kasi nga, like I said, there is a possibility na baka magkaroon ng premature delivery si nanay because of emergency CS. At pag sobrang maaga mong dineliver yung bata na wala pa siyang lung maturity, it can cause us a problem in respiration or initiating breathing to the premature large for gestational age fetus or neonate. Alright? So, kailangan nating i-check using amniocentesis para malaman natin kung yung bata ay makakasurvive na pa extrauterinely. Aside from that, we should also consider doing a test to look for cephalopelvic disproportion. Okay? Because there might be possibility for shoulder dystocia pag yung bata ay madedeliver using vaginal birth. Okay? What we do is we subject the mother through to x-ray. Titignan natin yung kanyang passageway, yung kanyang hips, yung mga hip bones niya, or your pelvic cavity. We will look into that and we will consider the size of the LGA fetus. Titignan natin kung kakasya ba or kaya ba niyang inormal yung bata. Kung hindi, or kung napatunayan natin that there is cephalopelvic disproportion because of the tests that we do, pwedeng i-CS na lang po yung mother to prevent shoulder dystocia. Kasi ang mangyayari is that kahit ma-deliver mo yung ulo ng bata, the problem will be delivering the shoulders. Kaya magkakaroon ng shoulder dystocia. And it may pose as a problem for both the mother and the child kung hindi magde-descend properly yung fetus during vaginal delivery. Baka hindi kayanin ng nanay at baka hindi din kayanin ng fetus which is being delivered intravaginally. So what we do, CS, emergency CS na lang po sa mga patients natin. So again, we can also do amniocentesis to check for lung maturity and also cephalopelvic disproportions para po malaman natin kung kaya ba ng normal spontaneous delivery or cesarean section. We also need to look for danger signs or assessments in the large for gestational age, especially immediately after delivery. Ito yung mga kailangan nating tignan or hanapin sa mga LGAs because this may pose as a problem and dapat malaman ng doctor immediately so that we will be given the doctor's order to alleviate the situation. So, isa sa mga dapat tinitignan natin is the presence of asymmetry of the anterior chest wall or meron bang unilateral lack of movement to detect diaphragmatic paralysis. So, titignan natin pag humihinga ba yung LGA, yung pantay ba na nagra-rise and falling yung kanyang chest wall or isa lang. Okay? So, pag nagkaroon ng asymmetry, report it immediately to the doctor. Bakit? The reason why there is asymmetry in the movement of the chest wall is that there may be cervical nerve damage. Baka na-stretch yon because of the wide shoulder, maaaring nahila yung mga nerve dito. Therefore, magkakaroon siya ng lack of movement on one side of the chest. So, you have to immediately report to the doctor if there is asymmetry in the chest movement because that may be diaphragmatic paralysis as well. Okay? So, we also look into the eyes of the LGA. Anong titignan natin sa mata? If it is unresponsive or meron na siyang dilated pupils or pwede din natin siyang tignan for vomiting or bulging of the fontanelles. Yung fontanelle or your space niya dito parang bumubukol. Okay? Or look for high-pitched cry, which are all suggestive of increased intracranial pressure. Maaaring nagkaroon ng malakas na pressure dito because of the compression of the cranial nerves, which will now lead to the limited movement of the eye. Dahil nga sa sobrang laki ng bata, ang liit lang ng passageway niya, especially if i-deliver siya intravaginally, makokompress yung ulo. Therefore, makokompress yung kanyang cranial nerves, which will now limit the eye response. Aside from that, the increased intracranial pressure during delivery may also cause vomiting. At pwedeng dahil sa sobrang lakas ng pressure, mag-bulge din yung kanyang fontanelle. So, if there is vomiting, especially yung projectile vomiting na tinatawag natin, report immediately to the doctor kasi baka may increased intracranial pressure po yung bata or there may be cranial nerve damages. Aside from that, if there is also lethargy or uncoordinated eye movements or nagjijitter yung bata, gumaganon-ganon, that may be caused by seizure. And yung seizure may be secondary to increased intracranial pressure. Again, there is a need for you to report lethargy, uncoordinated eye movements, and jitters kasi nga it may be caused by a possible seizure because of increased intracranial pressure. You also have to look for extensive bruising, ano, or yung mga pagpasa-pasa sa mga skin ng bata or other birth injuries such as broken clavicle, baka broken or fractured po dito nila, or what we call herbdoshin paralysis. Pag sinabi nating herbdoshin paralysis, the child cannot move his or her upper extremities. Pwede ding look for crepitus or swelling, which are palpated on the fracture site. Okay? Pag nagkaroon po ng mga bukol-bukol dito, crepitus po ang tawag natin doon kasi sa mga part na may fracture, nagkakaroon ng swelling. Okay? Or there is also poor motion of the upper extremities. Herbdoshin paralysis po ang tawag natin doon. Okay? So, bakit po? There are instances wherein when the large for gestational age newborns are being delivered, ang nangyayari po kasi is pag na-deliver po yung ulo, di ba sinabi ko kanina that it can lead LGA if they are given the chance to be delivered intravaginally, kahit ma-deliver po yung ulo, the problem will be delivering the shoulders. Shoulder dystocia yung problem. Ang nangyayari, yung mga ginagawa ng mga ibang midwives or nurses or doctors is that they are using the armpits of the child to pull the child. Diba ang ginagamit lang natin is the head? Diba? To pull the child, to coax the child to go out of the vagina or past the vagina Pero ang mangyayari is that yung mga midwives, mapipilitan silang ipasok yung kanilang mga fingers sa vagina and then try to pull the baby out to address the shoulder dystocia. And when you do that, when you use the armpits to deliver the shoulder, there is a greater chance that you are applying or causing trauma to the cervical nerves and other body parts. Or sa sobrang forceful din ng paghila mo sa bata, maaaring ma-damage mo yung mga nerves dito, therefore preventing the child to be able to move these certain body parts. Okay, so tignan natin, baka na-fracture yung bata because of forceful delivery or nagkakaroon siya ng herbdoshin paralysis because of using the armpits to deliver the child. So dapat matignan nyo yung mga assessment findings na to and then report it immediately to the doctor. Aside from that, there may also be prominent kaput succedaneum. Pag sinabi natin kaput succedaneum, it is the edema of the fetal skull. Okay, or pwede ding meron siyang prominent hematoma or yung mga parang bruising sa may ulo or molding yung ulo niya, pwedeng nag-overlapping na yung kanyang mga skull bones. Okay? Now, bakit merong prominent na kaput succedaneum, cephal hematoma, or molding? You have to remember that the head is exposed more than the usual amount of pressure during the vaginal birth because of a very large head. Dahil sa sobrang laki ng ulo ng bata, kasi nga LGA siya, and then because of a very narrow passageway, maaaring ma-pressure yung ulo, therefore pwedeng magkaroon ng edema, pwedeng magkaroon ng hematoma, or pwedeng yung ulo niya mayupi or magmolding, that becomes very prominent. Alright, so that's the rationale why there will be prominent caput succedaneum and cephal hematoma. Aside from that, you also look for possible ecchymosis or bruising or the bluish red black patches on the skin of the baby, or pwedeng may yellowish discoloration or erythema. Okay? So, bakit po siya nagkakaroon ng mga ganitong bruising or mga ganitong mga patches on the skin? It can be caused by bruising, ano, yung mga, because of too much mechanical manipulation on the child, pwedeng magkapasa yung bata. Kasi nga masyadong makipot yung kanyang dadaanan, especially if the child will be delivered intravaginally. Okay? So, pwede din siyang magkaroon ng jaundice. Bakit po magkakaroon ng jaundice? Because the bilirubin occurs from the breakdown of the blood, the RBC, or the collection of blood here. So, pwedeng after na mag-bruising, in after a few days, magkakaroon na siya ng yellowish spots dito, which is because of the breakdown of RBC, which releases bilirubin. Okay? So, those are the reasons why you have to assess the LGA immediately after birth so that you can report the condition to the doctor. You also have to look for possible jaundice in the LGAs. Okay? So, bakit, like I said, bakit nagkakaroon sila ng jaundice? Kasi nga, pwedeng magkaroon sila ng mga pasa-pasa dito. And when there is RBC death, pwedeng mag-release din yung mga namatay na RBC ng bilirubin, therefore predisposing them to having hyperbilirubinemia or increased serum bilirubin levels in the blood. Okay, so ito po ay because of possible bruising or possible polycythemia, which are also typical in LGAs. Okay, so pag yung LGA naman is born from a diabetic mother, pwede po siyang magkaroon ng rebound hypoglycemia. Ang nangyayari kasi is that the baby is receiving sugar-rich blood from the mother. Okay? Kasi nga, diabetic si mother, hindi siya nakakapag-produce ng insulin, kaya yung blood sugar levels niya hindi controlled. Now, if that rich blood reaches the body of the baby, eh yung baby, normal naman yung kanyang pancreas. So, pag-reach yung dugo na pumunta sa baby, sasabihin ng kanyang pancreas, oh, ang daming pagkain, mag-produce ka ng insulin to store that. So, what will happen? The body will also produce insulin. Ang mangyayari, once na kinot mo yung umbilicus, the source of sugar will already be cut. Ang mangyayari, yung insulin na na-produce ng bata, sobrang dami. Okay? So, the insulin will now store the glucose present in the body of the child. Lahat yung glucose na yun mauubos. Magiging glycogen stores. So what will happen? There will now be low level of glucose circulating in the blood kasi nga yung insulin, kinonvert na po niya lahat into glycogen stores. So there will become now rebound hypoglycemia. So what do we do? If there is a rebound hypoglycemia, the only thing that we can do is we give the child D50-50 or mga lactated ringer solution, okay? Or we can also give the child breast milk or bottle milk para makombat po natin yung rebound hypoglycemia. Now, let us look at the problems that may come with being LGA. The number one problem is that there will be ineffective breathing pattern that is related to birth trauma. Like I said, LGAs, when they are delivered, they are very prone to trauma kasi nga sobrang laki ng kanilang katawan. And the problem is that there may be nerve damages, okay, na pwedeng mangyari. It can also be caused by increased intracranial pressure dahil sa sobrang lakas ng pressure sa ulo. It can lead to the pressure being exerted in the medulla oblongata, which is the respiratory center of the brain. And that will now decrease respiratory activity, okay, or respiratory function. Aside from that, pag nagkaroon ka ng cervical nerve damage, there may be diaphragmatic paralysis. So what will happen is that the diaphragm will not be able to actively move during inhalation and exhalation. So what will happen? Yung lung expansion space mo magiging limited. So those may be the reasons why there is ineffective breathing pattern. Number one is because of increased ICP, okay, or intracranial pressure. Pwedeng ma-pressure din yung medulla oblongata mo, which controls your breathing. So that will now reduce the effectiveness of the breathing of the child kasi nga mismo yung center na of respiration yung natamaan. Or maaaring because of the possible nerve damage, magkaroon po ng diaphragmatic paralysis, leaving less space for the lungs to expand. So that's number one problem that you have for LGAs. Another problem that we may encounter when we are taking care of the large for gestational age infant is the presence of imbalanced nutrition. Always remember ano, na dahil sa sobrang laki ng katawan ng bata, the parents or the breast milk alone may not be able to supply or maintain the weight and relieve hypoglycemia in the child. Okay, so magiging problema natin yung imbalanced nutrition dahil nga sobrang dami ng demand at baka hindi kayanin ng mother na isupply yung demand ng bata, especially to address the hypoglycemia. Okay, so what do we do? Breastfeed the infant immediately to prevent hypoglycemia, at pag gutom pa rin yung bata at wala ng breast milk na lumalabas, the mother can give formula milk, okay, for the first few days, especially if there is rebound hypoglycemia. Alright, so pwede tayong magbigay ng formula milk in this situation on the first few days for us to be able to combat the increased insulin level na nangyayari because of rebound hypoglycemia. Aside from that, we also have to support and assist the baby in effective sucking. Like I said, problema natin yung respiration. And the problem, if there is an issue or concern in initiating breathing, is that baka mahirapan po siyang mag-suck at mag-breathe at the same time. So we have to provide support and assistance to the baby for them to effectively suck so that they can maintain adequate nutrition. And another problem that we may encounter in taking care of the LGA is impaired parenting related to high-risk status of the LGA. Okay, so what do? We have to speak of the child in positive terms to the parents, okay? Huwag niyong sasabihin na, ay, mother, ikaw yung may anak na dagul, di ba? Yung malaking bulas yung anak mo. We should avoid using those terms. We only use positive terms to describe the child to the mother. Okay? And also, you have to state accurately the importance of closely monitoring the child During the postnatal period, sabihin yung mother, dapat tinitignan natin yung bata for mga ganitong signs and symptoms, because sometimes the parents may feel confused of the need to assess or closely monitor the child because the child is deceptively healthy. Ang akala ng nanay dahil sa sobrang taba ng bata ay healthy siya, so they might not be able to grasp the reasons why they need to closely monitor the child. So dapat ipaintindi natin sa kanila that there are problems, underlying conditions that may affect the health of the child, especially if they are LGA. Aside from that, you also have to let the parents ventilate their emotions regarding the baby, ano? Because there are parents with who will have extensive lacerations. Magkakaroon sila ng mga fourth degree laceration kasi nga sobrang laki ng bata na dumaan sa vagina. Therefore, wasak na wasak yung vagina. So, what will happen is that the mother might hate the baby for that. Sasabihin niya, dahil sa anak kong to, naging wasak na wasak ang aking kipay. So, what will happen? There will be severed or problematic parent-child bonding. Okay? So, what can you do? You have to let the mother ventilate their emotions or answer their questions regarding the condition of the child. Okay? And then, you also encourage the child to treat the LGA properly to provide them with the developmental care that they need, such as talking, singing, or stroking. Kasi nga, basically, pag in-explain mo na, misis, medyo delikado yung case ng bata kasi LGA, ganito, ganyan, they might feel afraid of taking care of the child. So sabihin nyo, misis, dapat pinoprovide pa rin natin yung bata ng mga developmental care na kailangan nila by talking to the child, singing to the child, or hinihele pa rin nila like what they do to normal children out there. Okay, so those are the problems that you may encounter in taking care of the LGA infant or newborn. And that ends my discussion for today's video. At sana ay meron kayong natutunan sa aking discussion ngayon regarding the small for gestational age and large for gestational age patients that you might encounter during your professional journey as future nurses. Nawa ay nag-enjoy kayo sa ating pre-recorded lesson, so you have to prepare yourself for another quiz in our Edmodo classroom. Again, this has been Dr. Jeff Leigh Reburon na nag-iiwan sa inyo ng katagang keep safe and enjoy the rest of the day. Have a great day, everyone. Bye-bye.